It's like the paranoia.
I know. It's always, we stress. It's like, especially when we get like the bigger players and it's like, I'm so nervous. Like, please don't go wrong. It's like, their connection doesn't go, or Guga, we did, and his was so bad. And that was the only one where it's like, he's like, Guga, I don't know what you're saying, man, but we'll just put a lot of pictures over this interview and hopefully it sounds okay.
Just smile and nod. Welcome to another episode of Talk Tennis. Today, I am joined by Charlie Fox, who literally has like the coolest job in the tennis industry. I have a pretty cool job, I'm not going to lie, Charlie, but your job is pretty amazing. And, you know, we're still relatively new friends, so I'm still getting to know you a little bit. But I do know you produce a ton of awesome content and some of my favorite content for the ATP. And you've worked with so many different players. So why don't you give me your bio instead of me trying to give your bio?
I can do that, or I at least can try doing that. I own a production company. We work with a lot of people in the sport of tennis. We work with people and companies outside of the sport as well, but really our niche and where we've built a lot of our relationships and even our content has been within the sport of tennis. So we work with the ATP Tour and co-produce a large portion of their digital content. There's another company that we work with in London who also work on their content. But from our side, we travel to a lot of their events. I think this year we're set to do about 32 tournaments. And we do a weekly show for them with this other company called Clean Cut Media in London. And it's called ATP Uncovered. So that runs about 47 weeks a year and goes out in about 150 countries. And that's kind of a magazine style show with behind the scenes, off seasons, player profiles, games that we force players to do and they are good sports about, and kind of tournament profiles. And then we also produce a large portion of their the ATP's help with them with their digital content. They come to us with ideas and we also come to them with ideas, and a lot of the things on their Instagram, Facebook, Twitter are probably done by one of our company, the company I own with my wife called Sift Creative, and or this company in London. So it's been a fun run. We also work with the International Tennis Hall of Fame and help them with a lot of their content, do interviews for them, and help them archive a lot of the tennis history. And we also work with some of the brands within the sport as well. So yeah, I feel very lucky to have been doing this for about 10 years now. So it's been a good run.
Yeah, I would say that most people out there have, or any of our listeners have, definitely watched your content. I know even just in the office, we're constantly like pulling up those videos. Like, did you watch this one? Did you watch this one? So you guys are doing an awesome job. Really cool to see everything, especially this past year. It's kept a lot of us going. So that's been really cool. But I wanted to rewind a tiny bit. Now, your dad is someone that most of our listeners probably know as well, Dr. Alan Fox, and he has a little bit of tennis in his past, or a lot.
Just a little bit in there.
Okay, so I am very familiar with your dad and his books and some of his psychology stuff, but I was just doing a little research and I wrote it down, quote unquote, he's known as the ultimate achiever. That's like his bio.
It might have been written by someone in the Fox family, but I do like he is an ultimate achiever. He's a, I mean, obviously he's got quite a pedigree off post career, but even on the court, quarterfinals of Wimbledon, had a good run in this LA tournament, formerly called the Pacific Southwest, where he beat Fred Stolle, Roy Emerson, Santana, and Tony Roach to win. So that was one of his big claim to fame titles. But yeah, it was a lot of tennis in the household growing up. So I'm really, you know, I went into an industry that I'm really not comfortable with, really outside of the family domain there.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. So were you born with a tennis racket in your hand, more or less?
You know, I did not care for the sport or like the sport. And I think my dad, He also coached college tennis for 19 years at Pepperdine. And I think with that, he was almost overly cautious not to push me into tennis, or, you know, he kind of had it out there and I just couldn't care less about the sport.
Yeah.
And I was about 12 and a half when I first started playing. So I was a little bit of a later start in there. He signed me up for a tournament. I was playing for like a month just for fun, signed me up for a tournament. I lost, which I got very used to doing throughout my career. But I got really into it and then got the tennis bug after that. And then I was a little tennis nut growing up, watching all the old matches, ordering DVDs online of old matches. And I was, anyone who wanted to talk tennis results, I was ready to have that conversation.
Nice. So it seems fit that you are in the industry that you're in and producing and being able to geek out on a daily basis.
Exactly. There are times when you're like dealing with some of these people and you're like, especially the generation from before this one, where even guys like Grosjean and you're interviewing, I'm like, I used to love the way you wear your hat, man. Like,
the, like flip
up in the back. Exactly. It's like, it's awesome. So yeah, I feel very honored and lucky to still, work in the sport and go to a lot of these tournaments that I used to watch on TV and just get to see another side of it. It's been a very fun run.
Nice. And who were the people that you were looking up to when you were younger? Who were your like Federers and Nadals when you were younger?
Federers and Nadals were a good start.
Yeah,
I mean, Federer was there because, the first year he won Wimbledon in 2003 was when I was kind of just getting into it all. So I was really, I was pretty much been following Fed since, I started playing and now working in tennis and the guy's still here playing. So ridiculous. Roddick as well, just as a just holding the mantle and same thing, won that US Open in 2003 and followed him throughout his career. I liked guys like Guga just because he was fun to watch and all of that. And then, the kind of more as the time went, loved watching even just all the current rivalries and all of that. We've been very lucky to have these guys for this long. I don't think anyone could have predicted any of this.
For sure. Yeah. And they're providing loads of content and it's really fun to just dive in and be a fan of tennis right now, in my opinion, at least.
Yeah, it is. It's an exciting time because you have this old guard, but then you have the Sinners, the Shapovalov, Felix. I mean, there's like, 20 guys that are coming up between all of the Tsitsipas and Zverev. I mean, it's crazy the amount of names with the old guard and the new guard. I think tennis looks to be in a very good place, coming up.
For sure. Now let's go a little more current. So last year, 2020, March, you were at BNP. I was at BNP. We're all getting ready to go. And COVID-19 kind of hit the country harder than we thought. I think at least even being there was a little bit of a wild time. Talk me through how the year unfolded after that for you, for someone that is normally doing a ton of content and a ton of work with these players at tournaments. And all of a sudden, like, tournaments just stopped.
Yeah, it was definitely, it was a scramble. We were obviously in Indian Wells when it got canceled. I remember we were walking to the parking lot. Like, I heard little rumblings during the day that they're like, someone's mentioned like it might get canceled. I'm like, canceled?
No, yeah.
Like, you're not going to cancel the tournament. I mean, and then we were like walking to the parking lot and someone's like going through their Twitter going like, they just canceled the tournament. So we're like, wait, what do we do now? We're already talking about the next day. And so, we head back. We were trying to plan out Miami, naively thinking that was coming. That got canceled. And then we went to scramble mode because not only did we have all this content planned coming up, but we do have a weekly show with ATP Uncovered that doesn't stop. And so we started running some older stuff for the first week or two, but realized pretty quick that wasn't going to sustain. And really about like a week or two into that time, the ATP and WTA started having some chats about creating some joint content. And so we started, our team with the ATP got together, and then the WTA also got their team together, and we started just having some really planning calls of like, what could we do? And came up with this idea as a group, which came to be Tennis United, which was pretty much a weekly show hosted by Bethany Maddox Sands and Vasek Pospisil, who turned out to just be unbelievable hosts.
They're
the
awesome.
Show kind of took a life of its own. We kind of structured it and went through it as we went. We, you know, you and I talked a little bit offline before this started, but we had to learn kind of how to film over Zoom, what the plan was to record, and the technical aspects of all of this. And then, you know, it, honestly, I think the first episode came out end of March. So it really, it was really a quick turnaround, and credit to both tours for kind of being able to grab player time and lock all this in very quickly. Cause you know, our teams worked really hard to get it going, but you know, without delivering players and all of that, it wouldn't have happened. So yeah, so that was kind of how we spent a large portion of the first couple of months of the pandemic. We produced 18 episodes in total. It was a weekly grind. We had a couple guys on our team working. WTA had a little team working, and we'd have weekly calls. We filmed kind of, we'd do about like two filming sessions with Bethany and Vasek every week. We'd do one filming session that was like the intro and the outro of the show. We did a social roundup that they'd record there. And then we'd do a second filming session, which was generally like our guest of the week. And yeah, it was a lot of fun. We had, obviously from the player side, it was, I don't know how many players we had in total, but it was a pretty large number, from Djokovic to Murray to Edberg, Navratilova, Davenport, Henman, and plus all the kind of current stars and Kyrgios and all the players. So it was a lot of fun. And we got some non-tennis people like, Luis Fonsi, who does Despacito, known for his YouTube fame, and Dirk Nowitzki, Steve Nash, Wayne Gretzky. So it was really cool, honestly, to see a lot of that. And then obviously just the WTA stars from Muguruza and Osaka, and just it was fun. It was, you know, obviously a lot of my chat's been ATP heavy because that's the hat I wear on the most part, but just getting to spend all that time and getting to know some more of the WTA players and Bethany and all of that was really cool to just mix things up on our end. And it definitely challenged the creativity trying to come up with a 20 plus minute show every week.
Yeah. Well, and I mentioned this to you in an email, but literally that was like my life. Every time there was a new episode out, I was so excited to watch it. And I know even internally, like, we would share the episodes, and like, I remember when it was Vacek's birthday and he's like such a little baby face, and everyone, like, Beth was giving him a hard time. And then like the whole Australian Open, or the whole Australian Davis Cup team, or like all the Aussie guys, John Millman's like one of my favorite, and like they're all just trolling each other in the Zoom.
It was great. Yeah, I mean, that one was a 3:30 a.m. wake up call for me. I was that was the only time we could. That's the problem with like those big group chats, trying to get 5-6 guys together. It was like they're like, yeah, 10:30 Australian time work. It's like, yep,
nope, sure,
we're good for it. Yep. But yeah, those are fun. I mean, it's just great to see a different side of the players. I think even one thing we noticed is a lot of these chats that we had with them really got cut down, like Muguruza, Djokovic. Like, I mean, we went on for 45 minutes to an hour and like had to cut a lot of that content down. Or I know one of the first things we did was with, I think it might've been the first show, with Feliciano Lopez and Azarenka and Bethany Vasek. And they were just talking about a bit of everything. We were like trying to wrap them up. It was like an hour and a half of chatting. We're like, guys, like, we're going to use about 5 minutes of this. This is going to turn into about, but they were just, I think a lot of the players were just happy to see each other. And it was, you could see some of the personalities and stuff really coming through, and, you know, everyone was locked up and just happy to see each other again.
Yeah, totally. And I mentioned it to you, but it's kind of something that I watched and I was like, oh, I want the podcast, our podcast to be more like that. Like, it definitely motivated me even to have these fun conversations and connect more people together. And we actually recorded one with our team in Australia and Europe and myself. And it was a 3 a.m. call. It was pretty fun. But you know,
was it 3 a.m. for you or 3 a.m. for Australia?
No, it was 3 a.m. for me. It was like the perfect time for everyone else. But you wow. know, here for it.
Someone's got to draw the short, the short straw when you've got all those time zones. So
totally,
power to you.
Okay, so I want to spill the tea. Let's hear all the dirt. Let's talk a little bit technical difficulties. Knowing, you know, I'm not a super technical person, but with this podcast, it's almost been 2 years now. I've definitely had my bad days with technical stuff, audio issues, have completely recorded an episode and lost my whole audio track. Tell me about some of your worst nightmares or biggest fears with recording with some of these names that like maybe you grew up obsessing over, or maybe you're just kind of like starstruck by.
Yeah, I mean, it is scary. I mean, luckily, I'm just thinking we didn't have any major technical difficulties, like, thank goodness, yeah. on Tennis United.
Yeah.
We had, we went over the top, though, with our recording. I mean, we were recording individual screens. So we had, you know, on a call of four people, I made sure that we had doubled up for everybody that was recording. So, I mean, when we had four players, there were 8+ people recording. And so some of those, I mean, always a little nervous getting into one of those, but even during, for like the Nitto ATP finals, we did a bunch of content for the tour that was kind of reflecting on the 50th anniversary. So we got together a lot of past and present players, and pretty much every one of those calls was nerve-wracking just because it was like Federer and Borg. And you're like,
don't mess up. Like,
yeah. And you also just don't know how anyone's internet connection is. So like half of it is our fault. And then the other half is like, if Federer is on there and he's like, you know, stuttering and moving around, you're like, there's no other option. It's just like, so you're just hoping, like every time you see the connecting thing on Zoom, you're like, please have good internet, please have good internet. So yeah, we had Djokovic and Sampras with that, Hewitt and team. It was a lot of like, really fun pairings, but incredibly stressful, kind of just making sure it all worked. And so that's it, is honestly, we didn't have that really any big technical issues, but it was a lot of stress just hoping we didn't. And yeah, in terms of shooting around the world with the tennis, it's luckily same thing, nothing major. We've had some little hiccups and little bits of even just, you show up at a tournament and you're going to somewhere for 3 days and you're just like crossing your fingers that your gear shows up because you don't have a lot of time. So we've definitely had the tripod not show up or the lights and just have to get creative, or, you know, the suitcase doesn't show up and I'm wearing the same plain clothes like day three, and just like, it happens. But luckily really nothing major, and I'm going to knock on wood, yeah. because that's probably just gonna be like famous last words there.
I was going to ask if there's any players specifically that are like super technically challenged, like, I mean, to the point where I've done a few interviews with players and you're like, okay, you need to have good internet, you need to have your headphones plugged into your laptop, and like still they're like, they show up. Is it okay if I don't have headphones? It's like, no, you need headphones.
You need to wear headphones, please. And as I'm not wearing any headphones, so I didn't follow the brief, but my bad. I'll be better next time, which is the good news.
I didn't
news.
Even think you anything because I was like, he's got this.
I know, I should have not assumed. But yeah, I mean, we definitely had some times when we were texting players and just trying to get footage from them. We filmed over Zoom, but we also had them use their cell phones as a secondary recording device. So the quality looked better, and we were actually using the cell phone video, which is why Bethany and Vashchek looked so good. So there were times, like there's this guy, Marcus Rashford, who is a famous for in Europe, footballer, soccer in the States. And he's a Manchester United, I hope that's right, player. And we did something with him and Andy Murray, and he's, you know, superstar over there, filmed on his cell phone, wanted to get us the footage and couldn't figure it out. And so like, I was on the phone with him and his agent for like 30 minutes, just like trying to walk through. And we're like, okay, we're going to get there in the end. And there were a couple of those with the players just texting. I won't throw anyone under the bus, but,
okay, good.
You know, we had a couple feverish texting times where but that's why we always had the Zoom as a backup, because if someone couldn't get us their cell phone, we could always go off of the Zoom quality. So, but yeah, we faced some technical challenges throughout the way at times.
And I have to give a shout out to Bethany. We work with her a bunch and she knows her angles and she's always like, she always looks amazing. And just watching her on the Tennis United, I was like, okay, you guys have to make me look as good as Beth looks on these calls. But she's got some magic.
Unbelievable. She's such a pro. It, you know, I know I've seen her on TV and I've interacted with her over the years, but seeing what she did with Tennis United, where we're like, we'd sometimes have a script or it would just be kind of loose and we're like, all right, Bethany, roll with it. I mean, it just became a joke. Like Vasek was great and, but definitely not as much of those hosting chops. So we'd do an intro and he'd flub it a couple of times. He's like, screw it, Bethany, do it.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it was just nice. It was she was like a great crutch for the whole production of like, we need something quick. Just lean on Bethany. And she just executed every time, like one take wonder. It was pretty ridiculous. So yeah, I'm a believer.
Yeah, she's awesome. Now, who was like the shyest, or in general, not just Tennis United, who's one of the shyer players that you've worked with, who's hard to get to come out of their shell, or is like every player just pretty like happy to be chatty?
Yeah, I mean, different guys, some of the foreign, like some of the not the native English speakers, I think are just a little hesitant and just a little uncertain and just a little shy about their English. A lot of times it's better than they think it is. Mm-hmm. And so they'll be like, no, I don't want to do it. And then you just, it's about building that relationship and the trust that we're there to protect them at the end of the day. But so, you know, that's, you know, some of the Spanish players we've, like had to kind of get them out of their shell a little bit. But, you know, for the most part, most of these guys, I think they're so used to doing interviews and do so much that some are softer spoken, but for the most part, they're pretty good. It's always the guys when they first come on tour, it's like amazing to see the progression of these, like the next gen guys, the guys that they first come on tour to where they start and where they finish. Like I remember even Wimbledon, we interviewed like Fritz and Opelka and Tiafo when they were in the juniors playing junior Wimbledon. And then, you know, seeing where they came from there to like where they are now. I mean, those guys were having trouble stringing sentences together, just I think because of the nerves and shy. And now they're great on camera. So it's like a lot of, that's where I see it more often, is like the first little bit on tour and like guys who come up and are like media trained and ready to rock and like speak very well, like 16, 17, it blows my mind. So there's been a couple of those instances and it's always a standout thing where you're like, wow, that guy is very well spoken already.
Well, like even Coco Gauff, I know you don't work as much with the WTA players, but she is insanely well spoken.
Unbelievable. I mean, seriously, that's a perfect example. Like Coco, she speaks like better than I do for sure.
Same.
But she's so, it's not just the fact that she's well-spoken, but she's thoughtful. She's intelligent. I mean, it's just like if you didn't know she was 16, you'd say she was in her 30s. Like it just, it's not even like she's skipped the 20s altogether. I mean, like 16, 17, she's wise beyond her years. And same with, I mean, we did stuff with Felix and Shapovalov when they were, I think Felix was 15 and Shapo was 16. And same thing. I remember Felix, like he was like this hyped 15-year-old and I interviewed him. I'm like, how could this guy be so well spoken at 15? Like he just, you know, just the confidence and just felt like the comfort already at that age. You're like, this guy, once the tennis kicks in, like he's already ready, just like Coco, to be a superstar.
Right. Yeah. It's pretty cool. It's cool because they are so well spoken. It's like you almost have this belief that they can guide this generation, like they're in the right direction and we're all going to be okay.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like there's really, a lot of those young guys coming up. It is impressive, like Sinner and guys like that, that just they're thoughtful. They think about what they're saying. They're not kind of overwhelmed with the situation. And it's like, I knew at 16, 17, I was definitely not in that level.
No, not many 16 years, especially right now, kids are. Yeah, it's crazy. Let's see, who are your favorite people to work with? I'm assuming you probably have built a pretty solid relationship with several players. I'm guessing many of them call you a close friend. Do you have anyone that you're always like, okay, this is going to be awesome. I'm sure like all of them, we know they're all really cool guys, but do you have anybody's like in particular that, you know, it goes beyond just filming with?
Yeah. I mean, honestly, I don't just say this because I work with the ATP and the tour, but like, I like pretty much the entire tour. There's maybe like a name or two that, once again, I probably won't name on this call.
Yeah, no, but, it's good.
that I don't love, but for the most part, it's actually like the guys are really just good guys. Like they, you know, I mean, obviously it's a little different talking to someone right when they finish a match or lose a tough match than on a day-to-day, but friendly, nice. I mean, starting off, it's very hard not to say someone like Fed is awesome and a great guy. I mean, we've had some different times when it's like, even 2017, when he won his Aussie Open epic with Rafa, he did like 4.5 hours of press after that, when probably all he wanted to do was be with his family. And we did the last interview of the day about like 3 a.m. The guy comes in, he's done 4.5 hours of the same questions. What does it mean to win? They tell us, hey, you guys only have one question. I'm like, okay. And so I'm like, what does it mean to win? And he gives like a 5 minute answer, hitting the entire story of like the win. Cause he knows if you have one question, you got to make something of it. And you know, after it's like, he's walking out, I'm like, hey, Roger, thanks. And he's like, just trying to help a brother out. It's like, that's just a nice person when all, you know, just doing the interview is enough for some of these guys. So, you know, Federer, Djokovic, Nadal are just, they are honestly total pros. Team, we did an off season with him and it was really cool, not only to see the way he trains, but just, he's just been such a nice guy since he came on tour. And even after all of his success, he has not changed really at all. I really like guy Tsitsipas, just nice. He loves talking shop with the cameras. And
that's
so,
what I was going to say, because he's got his own little production.
Yeah. So he'll pick our brains and be like, what frame rate are you guys shooting in? What do you think about, like, so he's like just locked into it. Guys like Diego Schwartzman, just so nice and just like a lot of fun. Monfils, you know, I can run through pretty much the rankings and give little anecdotes on why I like certain guys or why they're fun to deal with. But, you know, I love the American guys obviously are just, we can connect a little more on the sports and different bits. But yeah, I mean, honestly, all the guys I really like, have had some fun times with them, some dinners and some various nights out over the years. And, you know, it's fun. It's honestly, it's the traveling circus where it's not just the players, but it's the same, like you go to Indian Wells, you finish, then you go to Miami and it's all the same staff. It's the same coaches. It's the same players. And then you go to Europe and it's this, it's like, there's a core group that is every time you go to another tournament or on site, it's just like seeing your friends and it's like going to high school and seeing like the group again after coming back from summer. So everyone's like really friendly, a lot of hellos and just it. That's what I actually enjoy most about the job is, you know, I like getting to be creative and doing the production, but I enjoy the banter and the interactions and just obviously the activities and getting to see some of the different bits, but it's the tour that's the fun part.
Yeah, I was going to ask, how much are you coming up with the creative? Do the players ever have a say, or do you have any players that have like come up with something cool that stuck and became a whole piece of content? And or is it mainly coming from you guys? Is it coming from the ATP? I'm guessing it's probably a little bit of everything, but you tell me.
Yeah, it is. It's a mix. It's, you know, the players don't tend to have a ton of things that they come up with, although I'm struggling off the top of my head to think of a specific example, but I know, you know, there are some good ideas that have come up and we're always keen to execute them when, you know, guys have come to us and been just, yeah, come with ideas. And it's fun when they can kind of take ownership of their own ideas, because it does, you know, when they're locked in, it obviously is going to make a piece of content better. And then outside of that, it's really a mix of us and the ATP. A lot of times we'll come to them with, you know, I'll send 15 pages of just like, I'll have a little notes in my phone where I just see something. I'm like, ooh, that would be good. Or, ooh, that's a series. Or, oh, that's a fun, you know, we do games with the guys where we did like a guess the grunt game with players where they were trying to guess each other's grunt. And that just came from like, I was sitting there watching a match and just like, I was in the other room and I heard like Rublev playing and he has such a specific, and it's just like, I wonder if players would recognize this. And so it's like, ideas kind of come from all over, or the ATP and their social team have a lot of good ideas. And so sometimes they'll be half baked and just be like, hey, we saw this and we'd love to do something similar, or they're more fleshed out and we're just there to execute and put their vision to life. So it's the fun part of the job, is it's always different. The content's always different, but the idea is kind of, it's fun to have the ownership, and, you know, they're very open to, good and bad ideas, or at least listening to the bad ideas.
That's awesome that you bring that up, and you can tell how passionate you are about it. But talk to me about the past year. Did you ever have days, moments, weeks? I'm hoping you say yes, because I certainly did, where you just feel so stuck, especially dealing with the pandemic and everything. And so many people are like, oh, this is so great. We have so much free time. And I don't know about you. I have a feeling you might have a similar opinion. But for me, it was like, oh, shoot, I got to work harder. I got to come up with more. What else? We need new things. We need like new ideas. It can get a little tough some days. So how have you dealt with those down days?
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, honestly, yeah, like Tennis United in and of itself was a lot of fun, but to come up with content every week, and it's just, it hits you in the face. Like, you just get over the line, you deliver the show on Friday, and then you're like, geez, I got to come up with content for Monday.
Exactly.
Like, we're already filming, we've got, or like the next filming is coming. So it's just like, it's, you know, it's hard to complain when people are going through a lot worse. So, you know, our problems in compared to the others are definitely not problems, but you know, it's times like that, it was getting just long and the days are long. And, you know, just for me, what helped is just, it really is putting things in perspective of like, I'm working, I'm, you know, it's a grind at times. Like the US Open, we went to Cincinnati, which was the first tournament back, and it was awesome to be out there. But then with the protocols and everything, we had to bring a skeleton crew. And so it was just me and a camera operator from the ATP side. And so it was up to us to get, not only shoot the interviews, but come up with the content and shoot all day. And then at the end of the day, we had to be in the hotel room cutting little things together, sending it back to editors, because we are the only connection between how the footage is shot and how people view it. So, you know, we were having days of just like going to bed at like 3:30, 4, up at 8 a.m. to get back to site. And it was just like, you know, a week plus of that was grueling. But, you know, it's the same thing where it's like, hey, I could also not have a job, or I could be, you know, my health could be compromised, my family's health could be compromised. So it really was a perspective thing, because you can easily get into that. Either, yeah, not necessarily feeling sorry for myself, but just like, yeah, you're broken. You're working. I'm sure it's a weird mix, I feel like, with a lot of people in these times of, you're either stressed because you're not working, or you don't have something, and you have the uncertainty of what your next thing is. Or if you are working, you might be working way crazier hours or way more than you were before the pandemic. And at the beginning, it was probably good for most people. And then that people are getting burnt out. And, you know, it's that vibe of like, you want to keep your work. And you also, you know, that work-life balance blur has gotten very blurry.
Yeah, I don't think it really exists in the tennis world, the work-life balance. I mean, it does, but, you know, it's easier for, I think, someone like you that's kind of, yeah, traveling and doing all this, it's easier. I mean, and also it's your passion. You love it. It's like, I wake up in the middle of the night with ideas and I'm like, okay, write this down. This is going to be really cool. So it's kind of like one of those things. I mean, right now the Australian Open's going on. So you fall asleep to tennis and you're like, oh, if I wake up early enough, there might still be a match on. So...
Exactly. Yeah, it's a good problem. And you get into it. And that's the thing is any job with what we do, I'm sure you love, it sounds like you love what you do. I love what I do. And even the great jobs have long days and tough days and stretches of time where the job feels exactly like a job. And, you know, I don't think there's an industry or a job in the world that doesn't have those moments. Some have a lot more bad moments and some have less, but you know, it's the nature of the beast. And, you know, I really do feel lucky that we've got to work during a pandemic, that, you know, we had the ability to continue and, you know, the alternative is much worse. So that's how we really got through it, but completely agree. It's there's the work-life balance working in sport and in tennis, it if you need that work-life balance, this might not be the industry for you.
Yeah. Now, what's one of your absolute favorite pieces of content that you guys have produced or you've come up with or you've seen manifest?
Ooh, that's a good one. I love the off-seasons, honestly. Like, we've done a handful of off-seasons from the Bryans to Jack Sock to Dominic Thiem, Shapovalov, Felix, Fritz, Nishikori, like, I mean, a lot of fun names. And I really love doing that. I like producing that content, but I love going to their training camp, seeing how they're going about it. Like, it's really interesting to me to just, you know, I see the guys on site and it's the same stuff. They come on site, they practice for an hour or two, they do their gym and it's like the same routine. And so this is kind of, those pieces are the times you can really see not only the personalities, but like a guy like Thiem, where I've heard about his workouts, but to actually see what he does. And like, I was tired at the end of the day, just walking around with him and I'm just watching some guy work out. Like, you must be shattered, man. like Chapo, the day he put in, it was like two-hour tennis sessions. He did gym in the morning, then he did gym at night, and then he did fitness on court after his second. It's just like, I don't know how they do it, but you know, that's why, you know, it's a 5-hour match and they look fresh as a daisy. So I love the off seasons. We went to Tandil 2019 and spent some time with Del Potro for 2 days. That was really cool. Just like seeing, he put together like a practice session for just, it was really nice. He did a food drive down there and had open practice session. All you needed to do to come was just bring some food and donate. And so it was just to see him in Tandil, where he's from, in that vibe, just the fans couldn't even hold back just seeing him out there. And so we produced kind of a longer form piece from that. That was really fun. We got beers with him and his friends in the mountains and like did some various filming around the town with him, which was awesome. We in Milan in 2019, we did a longer form, like an hour and a half documentary on the next gen ATP finals. And that was fun. Like, I've never done quite that long of a long form documentary. And it was cool. Like, the guys were just, I talked to all the guys before we started it and just said, look, we really want to do something a bit different. We're going to be like, you're going to see cameras in places you don't normally see us. We're going to go in your locker room before and after the matches. So unless you tell us otherwise, we will be filming. So, you know, that was fun and tough, where it's like a guy loses a heartbreaking match. Like Tiafo loses near the end, he lost a really tough match that he against Demon R, and we run off the court and like go into his locker room and wait for him. And it's just like,
no,
I hope this is going to be okay. Like, The guy's just like, you're not used to, like, we're used to when they lose, we kind of just leave them alone and we don't do many interviews after they lose because that's not the type of content we're doing. So it was definitely, it was fun. It was run and gun, but you know, that was just seeing the highs and lows from there was awesome. So yeah, not one piece of content, I guess. There's more than that, but those are some of the highlights for sure.
And we'll definitely link all the videos in the show notes so everyone can check them out. And it's kind of like when you get onto that YouTube channel, you just kind of go from one thing to the next and you can be entertained for hours, easily hours.
And that's what we try to do. I don't know if it works, but that would be the end goal.
I mean, I don't know if your team produces this stuff, but like some of the ATP, like best forehand winners, like that stuff too. We pass that stuff around the office. Like, did you see this? And make sure you watch it 2 minutes in. Yeah.
It's good. Yeah. We do a mix. The company that we work with in London do a mix. And even the, there's a tennis TV, which is different than us, but we work alongside them and they do a lot of that. So the ATP social team, for the ones we do, they have good eyes and they help send us a lot of those videos and we help cut those together. But yeah, it's amazing. At the end of the day, sometimes we'll spend all this time on like going to a hometown and filming and producing this really beautiful, in our opinion, cinematic thing. And then you put together like the Rublev's top five forehands, and it's like way more views and way, because at the end of the day, people want to see tennis, and I don't blame them. It's just, it's, you know, that's what rates. And so, yeah. And I'm the same way. I'm going through YouTube and I'm like, oh, what's the, you know, the most unusual points on tour? I'm like, yeah, I'll watch that.
Yeah, that sounds about right. We know the struggle on the side of that too. I have a few more questions because I could just like keep asking you questions about the tour and players.
I'm here for it.
Okay, cool. I have a couple players in mind, but who are the wildest players that you've worked with? And there are two that come automatically to mind that stand out that might be from California also. I don't know if you have any stories working with them. Hopefully they're the same two that I'm thinking of.
Okay, well, which two are you thinking of?
Well, they happen to be twins and
okay. Yep, they are. Yes, the Bryan brothers, I'm assuming. So
yes
yeah, they're good. I mean, unbelievable guys, like some of my favorites. I think everyone felt the same way when they retired. Just, it was, yeah, it's sad because they're so much fun, but they definitely, there's always just when they're together, you have no idea what's going to happen, as I'm sure you know. It's incredible that they could play for that long, seeing their interactions with each other, because they go from loving brothers to like explosion with the, you don't even know it's coming at times. It's just like everything's going all smooth, and then somebody says something they shouldn't as a brother, or got 40 years of just beating on each other, and the hair trigger temper to go on each other, and then instantly once that's done, go back to being brothers and being able to compete together, is, I don't know if we'll ever see that again.
No, it's wild. Yeah, we literally were just talking about one day they were on a shoot and I think Bob just rifled a ball at Mike's head and missed him by maybe an inch, maybe.
And yeah, it's just, it's shocking. Like you see that and you're like, oh my God, you feel like, well, there goes our shoot. Like, and then they're fine. Like totally fine. You know, we had some, we did a US Open with them. After they won the US Open, I think it was their 100th title, we did a media tour with them around New York. And so they were going, we were in a van with a bunch of, it was us and some of the USTA. It was probably like 10 people with them in one of these sprinter vans. And we're just going about it, driving in the car. They're just having a light conversation. And just the wrong thing was said by Mike to Bob. And it was just a very subtle comment. And it just turned into an explosion in the van that we were just, everyone just sitting there like they're going about it. And then we get out of the van and it's all good. And everyone's just awkwardly sitting there going like, wow, they're bringing all this up in front of all. Okay. Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, those guys for sure. And then, yeah, I mean, some of the other players, obviously a guy like Benoit Paire, great guy, love that guy. And just, you never know what you're going to get with him. Even when you're interviewing him, he's just quirky. Monfils, same thing. He always is up for kind of joking and just, yeah, he's a fun guy. And so it's like, we've tried, brought him in for an interview and he just decided that one day he was just only going to speak French for like 10 minutes. And we're just like, come on, but it's fun. You know, yeah. it's, you know, if you can't have fun with what you're doing and even them when they're doing these interviews and all of that, you know, you've got to find just the fun in it all. So I love the guys who actually want to go a little outside of it and actually, yeah, mess around a little bit. And just sometimes it's like wrangling, you know, herding sheep, herding cats, not herding sheep, but herding cats. But it feels like it's a little bit like herding cats, but it's fun.
Speaking of, I have to know if the ATP prank wars, is this an ongoing thing? Because I just rewatched that video that you pranked a bunch of the guys. I think Kyrgios was in there. Some of the French guys. It was hilarious. You can explain it better than me.
Yeah. I mean, visually, I think you probably have to see the video a little more.
Yeah, we'll link it.
Yeah. So we, that was another idea we just came up with I was a little tapped out to start the season and just wanted to do something a little different. There's this shoot in Melbourne every year that the players do for the ATP where they bring in the whole top 150 from qualifying through the whole tournament. And that's where they get all their assets. If you look on the ATP website, new headshots, if you see posters for tournaments, that it's where they get all the assets with the players and their new kit. So there's a video component and a photo component. And then we also have a setup where we not only grab players for interviews and we also act as overflow. If there's two players at the same time and then a third player comes, they come to us and we knock out a lot of content. So, you know, in 5 days, we'll interview like 60, 70 players and you don't really know what you're saying anymore. But so every year I try to do like a mix of features and games. And so with that one, we had this mouth, I don't know what it's called, but there's a game where you're supposed to like try to understand what people are saying with this thing in your mouth that looks like, I don't know how to describe it, but it looks like something you'd get at the dentist office.
Yeah.
And so I tried it out and I was testing it with our crew and they're like, we can still understand everything you're saying. And so we wanted to have players like try to guess words with it. And then we just started joking and we're like, what if I like wore this and like told players I had dental surgery? So it honestly started that way. We came up with the idea and like an hour later we were shooting it and I was a little scared because the ATP at the time didn't know we were doing it. Oh. And so we just kind of went for it because we were in our little corner in the back of the away from where everything is. So they'd bring the player around the corner and we just started like, we set up a little thing where we put a guy behind the pillar when they showed up so we could get a camera on me, but they didn't see, wait, why do you have a camera on Charlie? You never have a camera on him. And so they'd come in, I went in the bathroom and hid. And then our cameraman like set it up with them. He's like, yeah, Charlie's in the bathroom. He just got some dental surgery. And I wore this big thing in my mouth. And I basically, the premise was I was going to try to do serious interviews with the guys talking about pressure. And seeing what their reactions were. And so, yeah, if it's like a 4 minute video, maybe you could probably see it a little better if you watch it, but that was fun. It was actually very painful because the guys were, when you're talking about nice guys, they were all so nice that I was starting to feel guilty.
Oh, no.
Like not long into it. Like I did the first one with Diego Schwartzman, I think. And he was just like, they were most that, you know, with some creative cutting, it a little more of the best bits, but a lot of it was them answering serious questions, looking at me kind of deadpan, trying not to laugh because they thought I was really in pain and hurting. And just shows like all the guys, Kyrgios, Fritz, Tiafoe, they all were genuinely concerned. And when I did the reveal, I actually was like, a little pit in the stomach, like, please, I hope they under like the joke as much as we do. But yeah, it was fun. It was a lot of fun. I don't know if I'll be doing that again, but we do have a lot of ideas for ones for players on players pranks, which we were going to try to start doing, and COVID came. So I think you will see some, hopefully. I don't want to spoil any ideas just in case we want to actually execute them, but we have some fun stuff up our sleeve, and hopefully we can execute it in the not so distant future.
That brings me to another question. What does the year look like for you? It's 2021. We're recording this. It's the first week of the Australian Open. I feel like there's such a buzz in the tennis community. Like, we're all so excited that like pro tennis is back. There's some fans and spectators, and it's very exciting. But what is up for you next?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, right now we're grinding. We've got a crew down in Melbourne producing, filming content, and sending stuff back to our team. We actually were a fully remote production company, so we've got editors around the US and the world. So we're busy with the content, but I'm actually just not on the ground this time. We've got other stuff business-wise, so it just didn't make sense for me to do the two-week hotel quarantine. But luckily, our camera, one of our main camera guys, was willing to do it. And so he's out there just grinding turnaround content. It's afternoon here, and it's just starting to pick up for the day with them starting their day in Australia. So we're keeping in touch over text and working remotely with them. And then as the year goes, you know, we're going to tournaments. So I don't know what my set tournament schedule is. I have been trying to tone back the travel a little bit this year, but we're going, it looks like our next events for sure will be Rotterdam and Doha. And then probably Miami after that. And we might throw in a South American tournament or so, or Acapulco, or one of those events if, you know, we need a little more content, or depending on how things kind of shape up in Australia. So it's definitely a challenge and interesting just with COVID and setting everything up. We're looking into getting people from the US into Rotterdam, which is its own logistical nightmare, which my wife is our production manager. And so she's has the not so fun job of doing all the research and trying to find out how we get a crew in. And so she's, she's been working hard on Rotterdam and Doha, actually, as we speak. She's in the other room just grinding away. But yeah, so that's, you know, our plan. We still have ATP Uncovered, so we'll be turning that around every week. And so a lot of banked content going in there, but then a lot of fresh content that we need to go pick up. So that's roughly the plan, but you know, with COVID, you never know what's around the corner.
For sure. And you have traveled to so many places. This is a two-parter. If someone were to like put one tournament on their bucket list that they have to go to, what would it be? And is there a tournament that you have not been to that you would want to go check out?
It's a good question. I mean, there's a couple that I really love that have been fun. Like, I mean, in terms of majors, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this in the US, but I think Australian Open might be my favorite.
Really?
Like,
okay.
I mean, Wimbledon, each major has its own bits. Like New York and the buzz is awesome, and they do a great job there. French Open has its own vibe and is just, it's very French and got such that just flair in May. Wimbledon is, you know, the mecca of tennis, and just you feel history when you're there. And the Australian Open as a pure event, Melbourne in the summer is unbelievable. And the matches and the vibe and the crowd, it's like when you leave the site, there's just such a buzz around Melbourne that granted you have to go to Australia to go there, which might be a little bit too far of a trip, but I highly suggest that one in terms of the major bucket list. And, you know, if you go to some of the warm-up events, and the ATP Cup as a whole is a new event year two, and it's awesome. So you partner that with the ATP Cup, wearing the ATP hat, that one's fun. Yeah. And in terms of other events, like I actually really like Acapulco.
Okay.
If you're in the US, not too hard to get to. The players, the resort is at the same location as the as the court. So players are walking through, like you're in the lobby and Rafa's walking through and, you know, all the top players are there. Hopefully I'm not spoiling this for them where now we've just opened up the floodgates and there's a bunch of fans, but yeah, it's like, it's such a chilled vibe. Like they're on, there's, you don't have to drive to the court. So players just walk in like two rackets in hand, walking from their room to the courts in the elevator. So like a fan environment, it's a cool vibe. The matches don't start till like 4 o'clock in the afternoon because of the heat. So it's just, it's got a party atmosphere and there's a lot kind of the fun activities there. In terms of pure tennis, Indian Wells is awesome. Obviously the city is a little sleepier, but in terms of the tennis, it's like, they call it tennis paradise. And you really like, I mean, like a kid in a candy store, ATP, but you also have WTA. You've got all these stars. They've got the grass where you can, it's like being at a zoo. You get to like people, fans can like watch them in their natural habitat. You know, the practice courts, you can see like, you know, you go to some of the back practice courts and you can just, you're like one of the only fans sitting there watching someone like Sinner practice. So that one's awesome. But yeah, I mean, I could geek out on just tournaments and different reasons why I like different ones, but those are some of them. I think you really can't go wrong with most events, just depending on what you're looking for in a vibe. But I'd say those are a good little, that's a good little starting place.
I like those. And those all have like really good weather. So
exactly. We're lucky. We do, for the most part, we travel with the sun with the tennis tour. So, you know, it's we're lucky to kind of just follow the weather. And normally I'm in Australia this time of the year. So when California is a little rainy or foggy, we follow summer and sun, which is the nice thing about the ATP and the WTA tours.
Totally. Okay. I'm slowly wrapping it up, but you've worked with so many players. Do you have anyone that is on your bucket list that you have not worked with? And since you have worked with like basically the whole ATP, it can be someone who's a former player or even someone from another sport. If we have to go that far, since you probably like literally interviewed everyone on the ATP.
Yeah. It's a good question. Have interviewed pretty much everyone. Actually, Agassi is the one guy I've never interviewed.
He's on my bucket list too.
He's elusive. I've seen him and I've walked by him and said hello, but yeah, I've never interviewed him. So that would probably be up there from the tennis side. I mean, we've done, you know, guys like Borg and stuff like that, Laver. We've lucky enough to do some of that. Not all of these, Tennis United and some of these things have allowed us to, like a guy like Borg, we got to do, and that was more over Zoom. I've seen him in person, but never interviewed him in person. So that would be cool. I mean, honestly, LeBron, if you want to go another sport,
yeah.
Hard to say not like a guy like LeBron would be just for, yeah, that would be great. Luckily, I did some golf a couple weeks or a month or two ago, and I checked off the Tiger Woods one on the bucket list. So
okay.
That was there's the golf flex right there. But my golf knowledge outside of him and a couple names, that's it. So it would have probably been Tiger. Yeah. I mean, been lucky with on the tennis bucket list of most of them. I've had a chance to interact or interview, but I'd say Agassi from the tennis side.
Nice. So I also, like I said, had Agassi, but I think I want Steffi more than Agassi. Ooh. So
that's ooh, just... could we do a combo? Because I think both of them, Steffi and Andre together, I think is the ultimate win.
Right. Because
they both don't do much. So
We're putting it out there. So we're going to manifest it. It's going to happen.
We're great at recording Zoom calls. So, yes. You know, I mean, it's the sales pitch is there.
Okay, cool. One more question. Do you have a player when you go into these interviews? Sometimes I'm just speaking from my own personal experience. There's someone that you're like kind of excited, but you're kind of not sure what to expect. And maybe you're a little nervous about going into it. You've never worked with them before. Has there been a player that you've been kind of like going into it a little nervous, unsure, and then they've completely surprised you and they've kind of like changed your perspective on them and made you just kind of 180?
That's a good question. It would probably be more towards when I started. Like now, with the amount of tournaments we do, we see these guys so often that the only new ones really are just the guys like when they first break through and you just don't really know what to expect. You're like, does this guy speak English? Does this guy, is this guy nice? Like, does he, you know, will he be able to string sentences together, which you just, you never know. So one guy actually, I wasn't nervous about, but I knew nothing about until we did that Milan documentary with Sinner. That was a pleasant, he was, you know, I heard so much about him and I never really interviewed him before that tournament, which he went on to win, which was crazy, but it was really cool to just see his personality and just how his comfort just in that, on that stage and all of that really come out. It was like, I mean, before the matches, after the matches, I mean, he's in the locker room and he's just laughing with his friends. He's about to go play in Italy where he's playing guys around his own age where there's actually pressure and to perform. And he's just like he was like an 18-year-old kid, just like so chilled about it all. And then goes out, takes care of business. And he's like professional, but also just very like a kid. So it's a combo of, you know, he just totally handles the moment, reminds me a lot, not that I interacted or did stuff with younger Fed, but I've heard, you know, the things I've heard about him and the way he went about it, or, you know, he's just one of those guys that just kind of feels like the stage isn't too big and almost feels like he belongs a bit. Same with a guy like Felix. It's like guys like that, where it's just, you feel like they have this confidence, even at a young age, this quiet confidence, not really cocky, but it's just, it's a belief that I think the champions tend to have.
Yeah, I would agree. That's, yeah. And was Sinner the one that was potentially going to be a professional skier also, or did dabble?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he was like, I think he was number two skier in like the 14s or 12s in Italy. So it's quite a career jump going from skiing to tennis. But I think, watching him play, I think we're pretty lucky that he made the choice of tennis. But yeah, I mean, I would like to do one sport at like a decent level, but yeah, there's like, yeah, just skiing, or, you know, you have Rafa. It's like, yeah, soccer or tennis. Like, just some of these guys are just, yeah, that's why they are where they are. They're great athletes, not just in tennis, but in general.
Yeah. Ash Barty. She like, yeah, Ash Barty steps is a away.
Cricket. Yeah. Yeah. Being like, oh yeah, just low key. Just, I'm going to just stop playing. I'm going to go become professional cricket
golf.
Golf. Yeah. She's like, I saw a video of her the other day. She's like upstaging Tiger Woods in Melbourne. Yeah, just low key. And then, I'm number one in the world. I don't play for 11 months and then come back and just dominate again. So
0-0 first round. Like, what?
Unbelievable. Yeah, she's unbelievable. And so, yeah, I mean, that's the thing, is with both tours, it's like the amount of talent between the tours and the players out there, it's unbelievable. And I guess that's why they are where they are, is they have that athletic ability that is not just stuck in one sport.
Yeah. Well, this was a really fun chat, and it makes me even more excited to like dive into the Australian Open right now and just kind of watch all of the stuff and keep up with all the content that you guys are producing and all of it. So thank you so much for joining.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, that was fun. I was a former stringer for, you know, a little bit at Tennis Warehouse. So, you know, it's really deep in my heart. I wasn't at a level where they were ready to train me on the phones, so I never got that benefit of talking to customers. But I think I was like a month away from finally getting there before, I decided to start working at a little club around here. But yeah, I love T-Dub and really happy to be on. And yeah, hopefully we got to get out there on the Tennis Warehouse court soon and finish our doubles.
I know. Yeah. Charlie and I had doubles. It was pretty heated. It got pretty
good. Good. It was good. It was good. Good doubles out there. We split sets.
We did.
And then we just had to stop. So it was like, we'll never know.
Our partners were weighing us down, so they needed. No, I'm just kidding. No, we'll have to definitely get back out there for sure.
Thank you for having me, Michelle. It was a lot of fun being on here, and nice, easy conversation. So thank you.